Hello. Welcome to this briefing on the South Napa earthquake of August 24, 2014. My name is Jay Berger. I'm the Executive Director of the Earthquake Engineering Research Institute, EERI. We have around 3,000 members. We're a nonprofit technical association. I'm sure many of you know of us, and hopefully many of you are also members, and I'll let you know that we do appreciate support of our membership. Most of you are aware of the Learning from Earthquakes program. EERI's program that manages, organizes and manages reconnaissance teams after damaging earthquakes. We send out multidisciplinary teams to capture lessons learned, both in the physical and the social environment. And this can happen anywhere in the world. It's kind of rare now for us to have one so close to home. It's a serious event, but it's been a good exercise, I think, in many ways for EERI, the Learning for Earthquakes program, and the clearinghouse, which you'll hear about today, to get exercised. We collect and then disseminate reconnaissance findings. We issue preliminary reports, and then if an event is big enough, large enough, we do develop a special issue of earthquake spectra on the event. Today's briefing is intended to provide a summary of reconnaissance observations from the August 24th event. You will learn about the physical and virtual clearinghouses that were established. Hear from speakers on a range of topics, both engineering and scientific, from geosciences through business interruption. Although this is not a clearinghouse briefing, much of what is presented today came through in a significant way the operations of the clearinghouse. The speakers today, with the exception of the bridge topic, were jointly selected by EERI and PEER from the rather large pool of investigators who participated in the clearinghouse activities. And the compilation of observations. The task was not the simpler one of just presenting their own findings, but we've asked the presenters to reach out to others who have investigated in the same fields, the South Napa earthquake, and to present community observations within a topic area. The clearinghouses, both physical and virtual, provide non-restrictive mechanisms for community participation in reconnaissance and the sharing of observations. They allow the formation of a network of investigators who can make discoveries on their own, as well as augment the work of colleagues. It has the potential to crowdsource the reconnaissance with a guiding hand. Investigators can quickly learn which areas have been covered and at what depth, and which have not, so as not to duplicate the effort of others and focus on gaps and extensions of what has been learned. The data uploaded to the virtual clearinghouse receives credit and is provided freely for the use of colleagues. I suspect the new relationships created between investigators, the researchers and practitioners, the students and public servants will have lasting benefits that extend well beyond this event. I don't want to give the impression that everyone in the field participated in the clearinghouse and shared their observations. We know there were many others, individuals and organizations, investigating on their own and not checking in with the clearinghouse. I expect they will publish their findings, and that has real value. However, as a community, I believe we can make faster progress in understanding and acting on lessons learned from earthquakes through what one might call participatory reconnaissance and the development of an open collective knowledge base. I want to thank you for making time to join the briefing and invite Steve Mahan from PEER up here to welcome you as well.
Thank you, Jay. It's a great pleasure to see you all here today. We have a good crowd here in the Benatow Auditorium at the Citrus Center at University of California at Berkeley. My name is Steve Mahan. I'm the director of the Pacific Earthquake Engineering Research Center. And we have, over the last decade and more, had a proud tradition of collaborating with EERI, GEER, and other organizations in carrying out very rapid reconnaissance following major earthquakes and other natural disasters. We have, I think, about 300 people in the audience, rather online, watching this, as well as a number of people in here in the audience. We're going to be recording this and posting the seminars both on the PEER and the EERI websites. So if you can't hold out and watch the entire thing, or if you want to refer it to someone else, please have them refer to the EERI and the PEER websites. PEER is a 10-campus, multi-institutional, multidisciplinary education and research center devoted to the extension and application of performance-based earthquake engineering. And with that mission, it's really vital for us to go out and look at what happens following the true laboratory experiments where we have actual buildings designed by real people subjected to real earthquakes. This kind of in-depth review of phenomenon that occurs in the field has led to many important research efforts, including things like the Sac-Steel program after the Northridge earthquake. Large program is related to wood construction, some work that has been done in the wine industry, for instance, structural response of wood frame buildings, and so on. And I'm sure that we will get a number of research programs coming out of this Napa earthquake as well. We've also been using this earthquake as a little bit of a test bed to look at some newer technologies. They're not absolutely cutting edge new, but both in terms of LIDAR and laser scanners to document the actual deformations in structures. We have a set of drones from UC San Diego and Berkeley that have been out flying around documenting structures. And we're also doing considerable work in the area of business interruption and broader impacts of the earthquake. So we're very pleased to be able to collaborate with a lot of other organizations, including EERI, on that. We're going to be putting together a brief technical preliminary report on the earthquake, and that'll be posted in the next few days on the PEER website. Jay mentioned the virtual clearinghouse that EERI is taking the lead on, and I refer you to look at that. GEER is also putting together a report, and it will be either released today or in the next couple of days as well, and you should look at their website. I think this earthquake stands for a number of things. It's well instrumented, it's well inspected. It is sad for anyone who went through it, clearly, that there were many tragic and problematic issues that were raised by this earthquake. But it is a reminder to all of us that earthquakes do occur, that if this earthquake happened again in another area, are we prepared? And so I think this is something where we need to focus on: are our water heaters, in fact, bolted to the walls? Do we have an emergency plan for knowing where our kids and loved ones are going to be? Do we have an insurance policy for our houses? Do we have a retrofit and emergency response plan for our businesses and other important organizations? So anyway, that's my introduction. So I'd like to turn the meeting over to the Master of Ceremonies, Marcos Chatanis. And Marco.
Thank you, Steve. Let's see if the microphone turns on. Great. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Marco Chatanis. I'm a structural engineer with Rutherford and Chakin in San Francisco. I'm the reconnaissance team leader for EERI. And we're very excited today to partner with PEER on this briefing. I can tell you it's been extremely challenging to take all the various observations of this earthquake and cram it in a 100-minute presentation. So we've really worked really hard to bring it together in a limited number of topics as are outlined on today's agenda. We're really grateful to all our speakers who've basically embraced our mandate to reach out to others who've been out there and make sure that they're not just presenting what they've seen, but also what many of you have seen out there as well, and work together on that. And that's both through the Earthquake Clearinghouse that Jay mentioned, that I'll talk a little bit about in the next minute or so, and also through the other organizations that are participating. So we're really going to want to focus on the findings and observations today, and we're going to cut out the introductions and the formalities. So it's really going to be a series of back-to-back presentations that we're going to bring you today, and speakers are just going to informally hand off. So here's the agenda. It was also sent out to you through email, so I think most of you are familiar with it. We've condensed things into seven topics with seven speakers. I will start off with telling you a little bit about the Earthquake Clearinghouse, and then Tim Dawson of CGS will come up and speak about the seismology and geoscience aspects of this earthquake, followed by Professor Bray, who will speak about geotechnical engineering observations. Then Professor Barbosa of Oregon State University will talk about the performance of structures in this event, followed by Ibi Al-Mufti of Arab, who will look at the impacts on business continuity of this earthquake. After that, Charlie Scothern will come up, speak about lifelines, and then we'll round out the presentations with a presentation by Professor Ostani, again from UC Berkeley, about the performance of bridges. So you can see here we're holding questions to the end, both here in the room and for the audience online. So I think we had just over 300 people joining us online as well before, so probably more now. If you have questions, please email them to Heidi, as Heidi mentioned at the very beginning, if you've joined later. Her email address is shown here on this slide. And again, we're holding the questions to the end, unfortunately. So we're very pressed for time. I'm going to jump right in. So I'm sure many of you have seen Little League soccer matches, at least at some point in your life. You know that in those matches, it's basically 20 kids huddled around the ball and running around the field in a big group of people. So really no concept of positions, no concept of strategy, probably not the most efficient way to get the ball in the net. And unfortunately, earthquake reconnaissance is sometimes a little bit like that. It's all the individuals going out, looking at the same things over and over again. And there's nothing wrong with it, but wouldn't it be great, as Jay and Stephen's introductory remarks mentioned, if we were to share and sort of spread out and come back at the end of the day and share our things and work together in covering a lot more ground. And that's what the Earthquake Clearinghouse is all about. So CGS really realized this after the 1971 San Fernando earthquake and brought people together in one room at the end of the day and just have people talk to each other and discuss what they saw and make sure they covered more ground and learned from and shared the findings. So after that, then Governor Reagan established the clearinghouse in the early 70s, and it's been around ever since, led by CGS. So again, the goal of the clearinghouse is really to create a room, a physical location, or sometimes a virtual location where people can meet and talk about the earthquake and where people can share information. So you can see here at the bottom of the slide, in addition to CGS, there's a number of other managing partners, including USGS, the California Seismic Safety Commission, EERI, and then also very important, now back to OES, the Office of Safety and Emergency Management. And I think it's very important to have that seat on the table as well, because obviously reconnaissance is important, and we need to have boots on the ground right away to make sure we're collecting all the information. But at the same time, it shouldn't interfere with emergency response operations, and the data collection should happen safely. So having that interaction is very important as well. So this event, the last time the Earthquake Clearinghouse got activated was really after the 1994 Northridge earthquake, so more than 20 years ago. And things have been active. Things have been more active in the last years when Ann Rosinski at CGS took over. And this seemed like an ideal event to reactivate and test a lot of the new protocols and tools that have been developed and adopted by the Earthquake Clearinghouse. So the decision was made very quickly after the shake at 3:20. To activate a physical clearinghouse, and Caltrans really stepped up to the plate and offered their maintenance facility in Napa for this. They also brought out a satellite communications truck to make sure this location is connected to the rest of the world. And then EERI concurrently launched a virtual clearinghouse, so launched the websites and share portals, online portals, where you can share and gather data of the event. So the physical clearinghouse operated through Tuesday the 26th with nightly briefings and really almost around the clock staff from all the participating organizations, and I'm sorry I don't have any names for the Caltrans folks out here, that helped to coordinate groups of people going out there, that helped people to bring their data back into the various platforms and to make sure that people talked to each other and knew what they saw and what was left to be found out there. So I think part of the success of the clearinghouse is just about showing how many people came through it. This is probably not a complete list of names. There are over 100 people that checked in at the clearinghouse, and if we missed you, just let us know and we'll put you up on the website as well. So as I said, one of the reasons to activate the clearinghouse is that there have been a lot of new tools that were developed or adopted through the clearinghouse that we wanted to try out in the field. And one of these things is the clearinghouse field notice that was developed by USGS. Then EERI has created a website, a web-based platform where you can upload photos when you come back from the field. And there are many others. There's also ArcGIS online maps that were used in this event to share and populate data. And again, if you still have some data out there, we encourage you to put it up there and share it with everybody through the Earthquake Clearinghouse website. So the field notes tools is very easy. It's basically a PDA or web-based tool that will geocode where you are, and if you have a photo, you can upload it directly. You can categorize it in terms of the kind of observations you're making, and then add some notes, as you can see here on this example, of what you're seeing, and you know what you think is important or should be followed up on after that. The EERI map tool is very similar. Again, there are many more dots on there now than when this screenshot was taken. It just means you have to come back after the event and input your data from your desktop after you get back to the office. The ArcGIS layers turn out to be very powerful, and very grateful for everybody sharing that and having this up on this web side. So there's data from USGS, there's data from CGS, all the teams that were out in the field and looked at the fault. There are photos on there. Actually, there's data from the city of Napa as well. If you want to think about yellow tagging and red tagging safety evaluation program after the earthquake, that data has been brought into here as well. They're also tracking water breaks and things like that. So there's a huge amount of data that we've collected from this earthquake. So after the physical clearinghouse closed on Tuesday night, we've been continuing to operate the virtual clearinghouse. Actually, we've been trying to track teams out in the field through Labor Day, all the way through that first week, and then also done what I think is a very important thing is to share reconnaissance needs on the website. So there's a tab on the Earthquake Clearinghouse website that says, that's basically a shopping list. So if you had something you couldn't see, you could put a request on there for other people to look at it. Or if you didn't go out there and you feel like, okay, I really want to know everything about solar panels on single family dwellings, you could put that request out there and maybe someone would go and look at that, because you know we had plenty of people coming through that were like, okay, so what can I help with? So there's a lot of manpower that could be activated that way. So I think, again, the other side of the success of the clearinghouse is how many data points were collected, were shared. So right now there are over 5,000 data points on the clearinghouse website that have been uploaded, so that's great. Of course, there's quantity of data, but then there's what do you do with the data? So I think the next steps to compile, synthesize, and share all that data are going to be very important. Jay already mentioned the EERI is going to do a special earthquake report on this earthquake. We have the preliminary briefing today where we're trying to disseminate a lot of the information that was shared on these websites. And then again, we're going to continue to compile and collect the data that people have collected and hopefully share that with everybody who's interested and create these cross-relational databases where people can just say, okay, I want to know, you know, how many concrete columns filled or something like that. And you can ask that question and you find all the things that other people saw. So that's all I have on the clearinghouse. Next up will be Tim Dawson of CGS, who will speak about seismology and geosciences from the Napa event.
Thanks, Marco. Am I on? Everyone hear me? So I'm going to cover a lot of ground today. I was asked by EERI to present the seismological and geological observations associated with this earthquake, but first, before I get started, I just wanted to list out a lot of contributors to this effort, both in the field and in the office, and also a special shout out to Ben Brooks, who helped with a lot of the slides you'll see today, and a special thanks to the residents and property owners in Napa, because without their giving us access to properties and different vineyards and all that, a lot of this data couldn't have been collected. So earthquake overview, a lot of you are familiar with this already, but earthquake was at 3:20 a.m. on August 24th. It involved the West Napa Fault. It started about 11, almost 12 kilometers depth. Following the earthquake, there was an interagency response between CGS, USGS, academia, consultants who came out. I think Keith Kelson was one of the first people out in the field following the earthquake and verified that there was surface rupture. They're still tallying up the damage for this earthquake, and I think a federal disaster declaration was just declared the other day. And as of last week, I think there was one fatality and hundreds or more injuries. The other thing I won't talk about, there's people I think on this campus who are much more qualified than I, is there was a test of the prototype earthquake early warning system that's been put in place in the Bay Area in California. So let me just give you some background about the geologic and seismotectonic setting of this earthquake. as I mentioned before, it was part of the West Napa Fault Zone, which extends from basically kind of the American Canyon Vallejo area for about 40 kilometers up along the west side of the Napa Valley. It's considered kind of a minor fault within the San Andreas system. It's a right lateral fault, but it's a much lower slip rate probably than other faults that we look at compared to the San Andreas and Rogers Creek fault. It's been estimated to have about 1 millimeter a year of slip, but that's largely unconstrained by any geologic data. Fault was included in earthquake rupture forecast models such as USERF 2 and 3, and it's included in the USGS National Seismic Hazard Map models. And just down here in terms of earthquake probabilities, as I said, it's a pretty minor fault, and the 30-year probability in USERF 2 for magnitudes 6, 7, or greater was less than 1%. It's in an interesting setting. You can see here, here's the surface rupture, which extends from about Cuttings Wharf up to Alston Park and beyond in the city of Napa. In 2000, there was this magnitude 5.1 Yountville earthquake up here with an aftershock zone. This earthquake, South Napa earthquake, came to within about 4 kilometers of that aftershock zone up in the north. And then in the south, there was an 1898 magnitude 6.3 estimated Bear Island earthquake, which not well located, but there's been some speculation amongst people that it perhaps was on the West Napa Fault, maybe in the southern area. So here's a timeline that Brad Agard put together from a network perspective. And I'm just going to list out some of these stations and the times that they recorded things, plus some of the products the USGS released in real time as data became available. So the first station recorded P wave 2 seconds after the earthquake started. P wave hit Napa approximately 3 seconds after the earthquake initiated. S wave hit that first station 4 seconds. And we can just go through and see when these various things hit. The earthquake early warning network, four stations identified this and estimated a magnitude 5.7 earthquake. P wave hit Berkeley, where we're standing, about 7 seconds after the earthquake started. P-wave hit San Francisco about 9 seconds after the earthquake started. And here's just a screenshot of the netquakes, the USGS netquake seismogram that's down in my basement. And basically from the time the shaking started to the end, I was kind of wondering if I should have fast-tracked the seismic retrofit of our soft first-story garage. And it's still been on my mind. So S-wave hits Berkeley at 13 seconds. S-wave hit San Francisco 15 seconds, and we can just go on and see that. About the time I was logging onto my computer, they were already posting the first motion mechanism about 4 minutes after the earthquake, and with a preliminary estimate based on intensity and location. First shake map came out about the same time, centering it in the Napa area. So by that point, we kind of knew that it was going to be near or on the West Napa Fault. Second version of shake map, 5 minutes. Moment tensor, moment magnitude at 5 minutes by the USGS. Caltrans had a shake cast alert for their systems at 11 minutes. Pager alert from the USGS came out at 13 minutes, estimating potential fatalities and estimated infrastructure damage and cost to that. A human reviewed this about 18 minutes after that, an aftershock warning was submitted. Other pager versions came out, and shake map version 13 came out about 6 hours after the earthquake. I'm going to talk a little bit about seismology. I'm a geologist by training, so I hope people can forgive me if I don't describe this the way it's supposed to be. But we have several finite fault models that were issued by different groups. First is by Doug Drager using waveform data. Bill Barnhart at the USGS and I think Golden did a joint inversion using both waveform, geodetic, and I think later the INSAR data that came out. And then Fred Politz and Jessica Murray did a solution using geodetic data. The one commonality you see along this is that slip is focused north, unilaterally north of the hypocenter. here, shown here by this red dot, here by the star, also here by the star. And maximum slip was located about 8 kilometers away from the hypocenter in these models. And that's fairly consistent between all these models, with kind of an estimated maximum slip of about 1 meter. I'm going to go back to surface faulting now, just to give you a little background about the geologic context of this. There's been a lot of talk that whether this ruptured a new fault or had this fault been identified before, and it's a little bit fuzzy of an answer, but at least on bedrock geologic maps, this is one from the CGS preliminary map of the Napa Quad, the fault's shown here by these red arrows as a bedrock fault. In the Browns Valley area, it's actually concealed by younger deposits, and then up north near Alston Park, there's also a bedrock fault that's more or less coincident with the rupture, as we understand it. It's simplified, but in general, the rupture occurred where there was a bedrock fault. In terms of identified quaternary faulting, in the USGS quaternary fault and fold database, there is about a 4 kilometer long mapped quaternary fault in the southern part of the rupture from just north of Cuttings Wharf up to this old Sonoma Highway. This is a photo by Keith Kelson showing some of these geomorphic features. I know if you're not used to looking at this, it's probably hard to look at. But having walked this, there are tonal lineaments that you can see from aerial photography, as well as side held benches and a low kind of degraded scarp that marks where the rupture was. Just give you some photos of the surface rupture. John Bray is going to hopefully show a lot more from the Browns Valley area in the next talk. This photo here is just off of Buham Road. It's near the area of maximum slip. Maximum slip in this area was measured to be about 40 to 45 centimeters of lateral displacement. Moving up to the Browns Valley area, there's actually two fault traces up there. This is a photo from the eastern trace, and if you look closely at this center line and this side line on this on Browns Valley Road, you can see there's a left lateral offset. Moving south, this is the offset along the white line at Highway 12. This was taken the day of the earthquake, and you can see a right lateral offset and fracturing here. Then finally, there was a little small amount of triggered slip or possibly co-seismic slip, it's not known at this time, at the Napa County Airport across some of the taxiways. Here you can kind of see this in echelon stepping pattern indicative of dextral shear. And just behind off the tarmac, you can actually see a vegetation lineament from where the mapped fault was prior to the earthquake. There was a lot of data that came in that helped the field efforts during this recon. One of the main things was the SAR data, synthetic aperture radar data, that was flown by Jet Propulsion Lab down in Pasadena. They were releasing this data. Geologists like Dan Ponte from USGS and Jerry Tryman from CGS were able to identify lineaments and forward these interpretations to the field teams to verify. And in a lot of cases, a lot of these features were pretty subtle and probably would have been missed had we not had the benefit of the SAR data. Here's a generalized slip distribution for the rupture. Star shows the epicenter of the earthquake, and these red lines and the brown lines are tectonic surface ruptures. Blue lines are kind of lineaments identified in the SAR data. So basically, from Cuttings Wharf to about Henry Road, you know, the southern half of the rupture slip in general is about 20 to 25 centimeters of lateral offset. The high slip area off of Buham Avenue, was about 30 to 45 centimeters. And then in the Browns Valley area, you can see that the fault started stepping over to the east a little bit, and slip was kind of lost in that area in lesser amounts, about 10 to 20, and dying out to the north to about Alston Park, where on the order of 5 centimeters. There's also some minor slip identified on these eastern strands in Browns Valley is about 2 to 8 centimeters. And then the southern part of this eastern strand was probably less than 5. It was very difficult to map unless it was crossing a driveway or a road in that area. And finally, as you saw in that previous photo, the Napa County earthquake, not really sure how much there was there, but it was probably on the order of 1 centimeter or 2. This is a comparison between the finite source fault source model slip distribution and surface offsets measured by some of the UC Davis crew and the USGS folks. As you can see, where the high slip area is at depth corresponds to the surface high slip area. It's somewhat less total offset at the surface than at depth, but again, it's about 40 to 45 centimeters. Afterslip was an important observation that was discovered during this earthquake. Here are two photos. On the left was taken about 7 hours after the earthquake. On the day of the earthquake, you can see there's about 5 or 6 centimeters probably of total lateral offset at that time. I went back the next day, about 24 hours later, and there was about 60 or 70% more slip there. So it was maybe up to like 12 or 13 centimeters, if not a little bit more. Following the earthquake, Jim Lienkamper from the USGS was able to establish 5 alignment arrays to monitor the afterslip. Here you can see the stations. Afterslip's continuing at these southern or these 4 stations on the main strand. Not much has been really observed on this eastern strand. I'm going to talk a little bit about the new data collection techniques, one of which was mobile LIDAR scanning. Ben Brooks and Ken Hudnut have been spearheading this effort. This is their truck-mounted LIDAR scanner scanning system. It can scan about a 500-meter wide swath on either side of it. They also have a backpack version for walking up and down the vineyard rows. Purpose of this is to collect data about the deformation field in the near field to the fault, and also if they reoccupy these areas, they'll be able to monitor afterslip. And in all, about 160 kilometers of roads, this is a track line from their mobile scans, has been collected so far. So they're going to be working on processing these data and continuing to collect new data. Another technique, field technique, is structure from motion. Basically, it's very a modern version of photogrammetry, where a set of photos is taken of these features, and software is used to process it and create a virtual 3D model of this. Up here are some images taken from some curbs in the Browns Valley area. This was collected by Mike Oskin and his students. The great thing about this is that it allows data collection, very high precision data collection, of features that may be ephemeral. So a lot of these curbs, which are kind of difficult to tease out the details sometimes, are collected. There's a 3D point cloud that can be generated from this, and a quantitative measure of offset can be taken from these features. This can also be done from the air. Here's an image from Kate Scherer, who's been working on trying to use some of the aerial recon to do this. So preliminary conclusions. Magnitude 6.0 South Napa earthquake produced about 14 kilometers of surface rupture. Maximum surface displacements were about 40 to 45 centimeters along the central part of the rupture. That's fairly large for magnitude 6. Maximum slip at depth from the different models is about a meter. I think the location, extent, and area of maximum slip at the surface is in general good agreement with the finite fault models derived from seismology and geodesy. Although not zoned by CGS, the part that ruptured occurred mostly on previously mapped quaternary faults and mapped bedrock faults. Other areas where the fault wasn't identified was typically covered by younger alluvium, obscuring evidence of recency of activity. Afterslip was a significant and is ongoing in the southern part of the rupture. It appears to be somewhat less in the Browns Valley area. And finally, I think thing we're going to be excited about from this earthquake is that it was a test of many new data collection techniques, such as mobile LIDAR systems and structure from motion imaging. I really, after working with Ben Brooks and Ken Hudnut and seeing some of the results that Mike Oskin's students have been working on, I think these techniques will probably be standard data collection techniques in the future. Thank you.
Good afternoon. As you can see from the long list of people here, that this was a very collaborative effort. GEER, working with the California Geological Survey, as well as PEER, the Pacific Earthquake Engineering Research Center, the U.S. Geological Survey, geared with support from the National Science Foundation, was able to work in a collaborative way to capture the ground motion and geotechnical observations from this important event. I'll start off talking about ground motion. So there's two halves to this talk. The first half is a PEER GEAR joint effort, and Tadahira Kishida deserves a lot of congratulations for pulling this together in short order and giving us some insights in terms of earthquake ground motions. As you can see from this map that's been produced from a map from the USGS and collaborators, many of the sites are blue, which indicates less than 5% gravity horizontal ground shaking, the maximum component. And so there are some things we can look at in terms of site effects and single station sigma for these sites, such as Treasure Island and others. But we're going to focus primarily in the area where we have the more intense shaking, greater than about 0.1 G, and especially in the near fault region, when we have more than 0.3 G. Notice that we have one other location out here that was more than 0.3 G. If we start off by looking at this incredible number of ground motion recordings in this area, now many of them are at distances beyond 50 kilometers, but in the area for a magnitude 6 where we're concerned in terms of where we get higher intensity ground motions, this is PGA versus distance. This is spectral acceleration to 5% damping versus distance at 0.2 seconds, and then this is at 0.1 second. You can see that in the near fault region, things are pretty normal, what we'd expect. Now, every event is going to have an event term, and we see that if you look at all the data within 50 kilometers, the event term is negative for these first two values and only slightly negative for 1 second. So this is less than what we'd expect ground motion, for the most part in the range of 20 to 50 kilometers for this event, but more what we'd expect in the closer in range. This is comparing it to the new NGA 2014 relationships. And another way of looking at it is not just look at different values and how PGA falls off with distance and how spectral acceleration falls off with distance, but picking some of the more important sites, the near fault sites, the ones that were shaken the hardest, and look at how the new relationships, the NGA West 2 relationships, capture that in terms of the spectral shape and in its intensity. So you see the median estimate from the four relationships with a median estimate of VS30. We estimated the shear wave velocity at this time. That's an area that we need to spend some time actually measuring it, so we confirm that. But it's around 490 meters per second. So if we assume that, this is sort of the median, and then the plus sigma and minus sigma estimates. And you can see in the near fault region, you're not just capturing PGA and some spectral values, but you're actually capturing much of the data. Near fault ground motions are really important, and if you look at just the fault normal component, this is showing the velocity traces. As you remember, the rupture started at the south and ruptured to the north, and so as we'd expect, we do get intense pulse-like motions in the fault normal direction due to forward directivity. And this is a key issue in terms of looking at damage statistics within Napa. If I focus in on two of the records, the Laval Valley Road, this is showing the fault normal velocity time history, as well as the fire station number 3, a fault normal component. You can see that the peak ground velocities are high. They're on the order of what we'd expect from standard ground motion prediction equations. They're on the order, the maximum component is on the order of 50 to 80 centimeters per second. These are very short distances, less than about 5 kilometers or so, clearly less than 10, so we expect these level of shaking. You can also see the period. It appears, if you look at this, that there's two periods. There's a kind of a longer period that we're getting from a lot of the classification system. I'm showing the Hayden et al. Relationship, but similar pulse periods were gained from the Shai 2013 relationship. They tend to be longer period, but actually, if you look closer, you also see a shorter period part in there, too. And I think for the shorter period structures in Napa, that short period response is important as well. Another important aspect is not just the peak ground velocity, but what we call the peak-to-peak velocity. Because obviously, having this kind of pulse motion go down and then come up is going to be very damaging to a structure. Our predictive measures would suggest that these would be pulse-like motions, and our relationship essentially says 4 out of 5 should be pulse motions, and the Shai method with Jack Baker says 4 out of 5 should be pulse motion. So I think we're capturing that capability in terms of capturing that phenomenon. They're normally in the fault normal direction, but not always. In the backwards directivity direction, this comes up as a pulse motion, but it's actually the higher intensity component is actually fault parallel. If we look at the implications for design, and so this is some comparisons of recorded ground motions, the Napa Fire Station number 3, as well as one that's a little bit further south, the Napa College Station record. This is showing the ASCE maximum, as well as the design basis spectra, the solid and the dotted lines, the DBE and the MCE. And then we're showing the max component for the recorded ground motion in terms of 5% damped spectral acceleration here. And then we're also showing it against the actual probabilistic base from the USGS map. And you can see that in the period range of about a second to a second and a half at both of these sites, we have intensities that are well exceeding what we had anticipated, what we've designed for. And so we have some motions that have very high levels at a certain period range. And so I think it's critical that we look at things like forward directivity, but we also look at basin and site effects to look at that. You can see that the levels are up near the 2,500-year level. If we look at ground motions away from the near-fault forward directivity area in Napa and come down to a bridge structure, we'll be talking about bridges later in this meeting, we can see that the actual demand levels, at least for the Highway 37 bridge, are well below what we would what the system has been evaluated or designed for, and it's kind of at the 72-year level. There's always one that's a bit high, and outside of the frequency range of, let's say, 10 hertz or less, things are actually more normal, but the Carquinez array, which is at some distance from the actual rupture, you can see here, actually had the highest PGA, had nearly 1G in one of its components, and that's because of a high intensity amplification of around 10 hertz, as you can see here, and that amplification of the high intensity, of the high frequency motion brings up the PGA as well. And so why did this happen is one of the pressing moments that we have to conduct some research on. What Tadahira did initially is saying, let's go ahead and look at stations along the rupture, along the strike of the rupture. So let's look at, for example, at Vallejo 37, Highway 37, the site that we looked at before. You can see two significant periods of intense ground shaking, separated by a little bit of a quieter at time. And you can see that some are higher frequency, although not as high as frequency as what you see at Carquinez. Carquinez actually has two downhole arrays, and these are the two surface motions, the array number 1 as well as array number 2. And you see it at array number 2, and you just see a more amplified, intense version at 10 hertz in array number 1. And then by the time you get down to the Panola Ridge, you don't see that anymore. But the fact that we see it in the Highway 37 station as well as at this other station number 2, we think that this may be some type of path effect, and it needs to be explored further. However, there's also other things. It could be a local basin effect. It could be some local site effect. In investigating site effect, we looked at the measured shear wave velocity. This downhole array has measured shear wave velocity over the upper 45 meters. There's two arrays that are back-to-back. The deeper array, array number 2, they're at 60 and 125 meters depth, and array number 1 is from 46 20, and of course, they're both at the ground surface. You can see that that kind of waveform is consistently seen through the entire profile. And so it's not a near surface effect. It's there and it's being amplified near surface, but it's in the motion. Now, at depth, one of the other issues, it could be a soil structure interaction issue, and so that needs to be explored as well. And so we've had other earthquakes give us these unusually high ground motion. This is the one that it's going to require some time to investigate further. In terms of geotechnical effects, there's the GEER effort really focused on this. And actually, Julian was a key person with all of these other participants to collect this geotechnical data before it was lost. One of the important things that, as Tim mentioned, is surface fault rupture effects. And it's really important to capture that, obviously, in the vineyard, but even more important when it interacts with engineered facilities. So that's where we focus, is looking at surface fault rupture and its effects in the Browns Valley area. This is actually a housing development that was developed around the 80s, where we have largely fill in this area, some cut in this area. So we're seeing the interaction of the rock coming up to the fill, interacting with houses that are built on top of that. And this is a blow-up showing the surface traces that cuts through the lower part of the Browns Valley area. This is a rupture. You can see it in the streets. You can see it in the curb. It just misses this house, and there's a little bit of rigid body movement in response to that, because remember, there's deformation off the main trace. It's not just the deformation on the main trace itself. But the main trace itself, which is on the order of, let's say, 10 to 20 centimeters, as Tim mentioned, through this area, hits this house directly and leads to damage to its foundation. There's two types of foundations there. There are some ring wall foundation strip footings, basically with interior posts and supported that support a timber floor. And there's also some piers. When the piers are in the ground, we clearly saw a higher incident of damage because the piers are tied to the ground. They go with the ground, and that damage is thrown up into the superstructure. But there was some significant damage to some of the other foundations as well. Detailed maps have been produced on 27 of these houses. Homeowners were very nice in allowing us to have access. And so this data is available in the report, and it's going to be very useful for looking at things in depth in terms of how these buildings responded to surface fault rupture and how the different foundation types responded. Some of the key observations are that, on average, the deformation observed in the foundations was on the order of 11 centimeters. When the concrete slab was unreinforced, it was severely cracked. When it was reinforced, it was more of a stiff, rigid body deformation, either tilting or sliding horizontally on the ground beneath it. There were separations where there were cold joints. And when we had structures on piers, they tended to basically have shear through the foundation, as well as transmitting that deformation up through the structure. There were a few homes that were seismically retrofit or newer construction, and statistically they did better than the non-retrofitted buildings. One of the things that we also saw is off the main trace in the Browns Valley area, typically to the west, we saw alternating areas of curb buckling, as shown here, and compression, as well as extension, as shown here with minor little cracks. But when you add up these little cracks along a zone, you end up getting actually deformation that's significant. This is interesting in the sense that someone had just laid down a carpet of grass. It actually has a geosynthetic on the back, and it looked like a wave had gone through it in terms of how it had buckled in response to the ground movements. And so we had a team actually just focus by collecting deformation along the trace of the fault, that's the yellow line here, but then also going off the fault to the east and to the west, but much of the effort was in the western side where we saw a lot of this curb buckling and the tenting of the sidewalks as well as the extensional features, and measuring up essentially the zones. And so there were places where there were no strain, that's the red zones. Then there were areas that were essentially significant compression, and that's blue, and then green is significant extension. You didn't see this in the houses. You didn't see this normally in the grass, except if it was just laid down carpet. You saw it only in these stiff collector elements. It's almost like someone knew there was going to be an earthquake here, and they wanted to collect the ground deformation, so they put these very stiff strain collectors called sidewalks out there to collect the information. They've done the calculations, and when you add up all these extension zones, you get on the order of a few centimeters of movement. When you take this into consideration, you get a few centimeters of compression. When you add it all up, and this is one case in the east-west direction on the roads that were going east-west on both north and south sides of the street, west and east of the fault, it basically adds up to zero. So at first I thought there was net compression in this area. I thought maybe this is going toward a slope, but it appears like the compression's evening out with the extension. You do see the net compression of where the fault is, and so maybe this is some of a transient. It's the clues that there was this transient surface wave on this cut fill material that essentially left this, but there also could be some permanent ground deformation issues that need to be explored further. We looked, and this is just showing some of the traces, But we're geotechnical engineers, so we look for liquefaction. There were very few incidents of liquefaction from this event. But that's still important, because now we always talk about liquefaction triggering, and we want to find where the sand boils are so we can say, ah, this site liquefied. It's equally important, I could argue maybe more important, because we tend to focus on where we see liquefaction, where there wasn't liquefaction. The ground shaking was relatively intense in a lot of these areas. A number of these areas had been mapped as being susceptible to liquefaction, yet this is the best we could do. You know, in the riverbed of no consequence in the Napa River, and maybe one site out next to a levee that had no damage, as much as we looked, we basically found, even in areas with hydraulic fill, we didn't find liquefaction. Dams were important, and we looked at dams. Les Harder led that crew. There were a number of dams built in the area, and one of the important ones in terms of finding the most damage, this is the biggest crack I can show you. It's about 2 to 3 centimeters crack, longitudinal crack along the 18-meter high Lake Marie Dam. So finishing up, where do we go forward from this? We've collected a lot of good information. The most important thing is that report that Steve talked about, the GEER, CGS, PEER, USGS report. It's posted on the website, and we can look at intense pulse-like motions. We got to figure out what happened at Carquinez. There's important issues in terms of surface fault rupture, the unusual compression and extension zones. The cases of non-liquefaction are important to document, and these other important things as well. Most importantly, if you are going to live on this earth, being underground is the best place to store your wine. Thank you.
Thank you all for being here. I'd like to thank EERI and PEER for promoting this, and also Marco and Heidi, big number of people that allowed this to be possible. And I'd also like a word for the Kiewit Center at Oregon State University that funded my initial trip to come down to Napa. As you'll see in many of these slides, there are, again, many, many contributors to this. And this I really have to call out to a great number of people that sent their information, sent their pictures. Really, I think it's a time where we start having, you know, Facebooks and Twitters, but we should also have a EERI/PEER community app where we can all share our findings. And it was a great experience for me, at least, to be able to communicate with all these people. And you'll see there are many, and then people, and I'll go essentially through URM buildings, housing. I'll mention a few other structures in terms of what we saw as a community, and then a few takeaway messages. And I'll start, because I'm going to focus on the city of Napa, I'll just start by showing this response vector, where I show for the Netquake station what are the response vector. And again, at least for this station, we see that in the north-south component, so the fault rupture was north-northwest, more or less, and the north-south components where we have the largest, but we're also plotting here the geometric mean, because as we start selecting ground motions, and we have to think of what is the best way to select ground motions, I thought it'd be useful to also have this represented here. So I'm going to focus mainly on Napa and URM buildings, and around Napa, so that's why I wanted to have this, which is a station right in downtown Napa. And in terms of peak ground acceleration, it was 0.61 g that was observed. I'm talking about a community and how, what was the data and what was the process in which this data was collected. And first, early on, there was a list of URMs that was provided by the California Seismic Safety Commission. And this comes from essentially from work of the city of Napa, which promoted an ordinance to retrofit buildings in 2006. And so the number of buildings that I even will mention here shortly is related to that assessment from 2006. Since that ordinance, there are other buildings that have been retrofitted, and we still have to update what we know in terms of what are retrofitted buildings and what aren't. As the clearinghouse was started, and you've heard about that, I won't go over that too much, but we all also used Google Maps, Street View, to get more information about the buildings that we were going to see out in the field, gather collect the data from the Strong Motion Center, and as it became available. And the city of Napa actually did a pretty good job of giving us updates in terms of retrofitted buildings. And early on, they put up also, along with the EERI clearinghouse, that had that in parallel, but the city of Napa also had a lot of information about red tags and yellow tags. So in terms of collection of the field data, most of the people either used ATC 20 forms, the rapid evaluation form, and the I have here my little cheat sheet, the post-disaster performance, so all of these letters here, post-disaster performance committee has also an earthquake performance evaluation program, and they have somewhat of a different form that they fill, but it's at least when I looked at it, it seems pretty useful. And so other ways of collecting data, and now we're synthesizing all of this data. So starting out, the Napa's URM inventory, it was first brought to attention that approximately 50 buildings corresponded to this URM inventory, and many were in areas of strong shaking. And this inventory was available as soon as Sunday afternoon. And out of this, again, data from 2006, approximately 20 buildings had been retrofitted. Out of these buildings, retrofitted and non-retrofitted, 18 buildings had been given red tags, and including 7 retrofitted buildings. So moving on in terms of what was seen, in terms of the damage. So two of these important buildings are stone masonry buildings that had had retrofits. And these are important because, to a more or lesser extent, because of the collapse of the stone masonry, this could be a life safety issue. The buildings are standing. Here on the left, you can see some of the framing, and you see some of the retrofits that were done, but there was notable damage. And here on the right, we have, this is the Goodman Library. It was actually a building that was retrofitted with some FEMA funding. And but you see that there was, in the corners, there was that damage that was observed. As you start retrofitting buildings, and we start seeing more and more of out-of-plane failures. So these are examples here on the top and on the right of retrofitted buildings, while the one on the left is not, on the bottom left, is not retrofitted. But here the retrofits were that along the roof and along the floors that you had the ties going into the building, but then this had a clear out-of-plane failure. And here the unretrofitted building, and this is about 400 feet away from that Netquake station that I talked about. You saw this out-of-plane failure here. This is a building that has been a lot in the news. It did have retrofits, and here the only thing that may be worth pointing out was that this had a 2-wide wall and then an extra brick layer outside those 2-wide URM walls, and these smooth dowels basically were only not really capturing all the 3 layers of brick, and that may be a reason why this tends to fall. Also, the structural geometry may help there. And here's just a close-up of what was shown there. Wall-to-floor diaphragm failures were also observed. So again, things that we know can happen. This one is a little bit strange because the wall seems to be plumb even after the earthquake, but you see here that this is really sticking out, right? So there was some failure and something happened here that we'll have to also learn more and try to understand more about the behavior of the building, knowing especially we have that ground motion very, very close to it, so that's going to be useful for us. There was, in the back wall, an out-of-plane failure, and so that may help explain what's going on here, but it's not one which is easy to explain. Several buildings had comprehensive retrofits. This is an example of a building that had a comprehensive retrofit, but it was red tagged. Okay, this is one of the buildings that was red tagged, and it was red tagged, and you know I wouldn't argue either way, rightly so or not, but it was red tagged because there was a falling hazard, right? So being that falling hazard, which was this cracked cornice. And actually, if you look a little bit closer, you'll start seeing that here the main panel is cracked. Because of that, it was red tagged. So this starts bringing questions that have been around for a while in terms of, are we too conservative or not in terms of tagging the building? But you know, it's in terms of there was the falling hazard, so it probably was done rightly so. Other examples of comprehensive retrofits. Here is a very interesting one, which the whole block was retrofitted, and the whole block performed pretty well. There was some minor, what I would call minor damage here, and there's some question in terms of the ties, if they were sufficient or not. But overall, it still performed very well, and you see the interior of the retrofit, so pretty open space, and all the URM is exposed, so a very interesting retrofit there. In terms of corners, this is again the Goodman Library, so there are typical corner damage that was observed, and that's a question that is still there in terms of looking at corners. We look a lot at out-of-plane failures, a lot of in-plane failures. In terms of research, there is room to know more and to have the combined effect and model those. Another interesting retrofit here with braced frames, where this is right near the creek, so we're less than 100 feet from the network station, and the chevron braces did what they were supposed to do, right? So in terms of retrofit, it was an effective retrofit, at least for us, structural engineers, right? So we're learning more and more about the buildings themselves, and this is a building that has a steel frame inside and seems to have the infill masonry. And so this is the post office building, and we see some examples of, textbook examples almost, I'd say, of failures, where you see here the shear and wall failure, you see rocking failures of the piers, and just some glazing damage here, and also the end piers, that's that one there. Very clearly the stepped failure. Okay. Some other buildings that were URM or a mix of steel framing and URM. This is one where we're still trying to completely be sure about the type of building. So again, ATC20 rapid evaluations, and then as you learn more about the buildings, you can do detailed evaluations. So we're at that stage now of doing more detailed evaluations. But here you do see weak pier, strong spandrel behavior here on the left. So clearly the 45 or here almost 60 degree failure. And this is the building, so you have an idea of what it is. An interesting retrofit strategy here, which is that they retrofitted along the height also. And not very visible here, but there's also retrofits along the left in terms of tying everything together. Some numbers in terms of retrofitted versus unretrofitted buildings. And this is, there's two things here. One is, again, we started off working with that initial database of the 40 to 50 buildings that were received on Sunday afternoon. But also, in terms of the city of Napa, at least when this slide was made, there were 40 buildings that are right now identified as URM that were characterized. And there's some interesting things here. This orange is something that we as a group and think is worth highlighting, because these are buildings that were red tagged because of adjacent buildings that had potential failure. So going to a summary and jumping then to the next topic, there's confirmed vulnerability of URMs. In terms of life safety and collapse prevention, buildings in general, and the retrofitted buildings in general, performed well. Parapets were still vulnerable, and corners are susceptible to damage. So there's still more that we can do there, even in terms of research. Generally, retrofitted buildings show less severe damage. There's still, in terms of preventing damage, it's still difficult, and there were still retrofitted buildings where there was damage, and we need to learn more about why that happened. And in interest of time, I'll just leave here a question, which is great opportunity to learn from performance of retrofitted buildings, and we should actively go and learn from those that also performed well. Moving to the next two topics. So first, talk a little bit about single family housing. And this is the type of failures that we saw, cripple wall failures, cripple wall tilting, occasionally sliding and shifting of houses too, porch collapses and chimneys were. And here are a few examples of cripple wall failures. So this is something that we know can happen. And it's been documented in many other failures. But the main issue then also has to, not only because of the house, but it can start fires. There's also several utilities, and it can be an additional danger afterwards. So just to say that there are successful retrofits. On the left is a house that was retrofitted, and it was collapsing. And the one on the right, the blue house, was fine. And we were trying to learn more about exactly what was the retrofit. But the owner said that it was retrofitted. And here are examples of retrofits that you can do. You can add plywood, and you can just make sure that there's no sliding. Chimneys, it's a hazard, and we know it's a hazard. There's things that can be done. There is some question in terms of when you have little reinforcement, and these actually do fall, but they fall as a rigid block. We don't really know what is worse, if it's the one here on the left or the one here on the right, but they are hazards. Mobile homes, several mobile homes were also visited. And in some cases, drones were used also to assess these buildings. And these are examples. First, on the left is just Google Earth video. But then these two here are actually outputs of drones that were used. If you go under the houses, you see typical problems associated with mobile homes. And the foundations are typically concrete blocks or just not even attached to the mobile home. And then this happens, right? So there's homes that had up to 12 inches of offset. Other structures, wineries, and this is one that has been in the news here on the left. So this was a heavy timber framing, three-story high. But also storage tanks is something that was alerted for the wines, and some of these were not full because they were still waiting for the wines and for the grapes to come in after the harvest. But there was damage, and EB will talk a little bit more about those. There's a case that's being right now tracked, which was of a roof structure that started to collapse. And the last I've heard, it actually did collapse. So just like the faults keep increasing, the roofs keep falling after there's been some damage. Drone footage of a warehouse. From the street, this is what we can see on the left. But then with the drones, we can actually go and fly on top and learn a little bit more and improve our reconnaissance. Parking structures and skywalks. This was the only thing I observed in terms of the parking structure. Some cracking at a corner at a short column, one of those columns, and looking at a shear failure and a skywalk that there was actually pounding that we observed. Last one, non-ductile reinforced concrete building in Vallejo, where the typical but unfortunate cracking patterns that we see in these types of structures also appeared. So just to wrap up, there's a lot that can be learned about the successful cases. Some of these buildings were subjected to a 5.2 and now to a 6.0 magnitude earthquake. And so we can learn a lot from the buildings that performed well. Retrofitted buildings in general performed well, but well for us is limited safety and collapse prevention. It's still difficult to avoid the damage. Tagging of buildings may be somewhat conservative, but you know, whenever you're out in the field, you have to make that call. So we understand that. New technologies make for improved reconnaissance. We need to know how to best integrate them. And it's a wake-up call, really, not only for California, but also for where I'm at now, Oregon, Washington, and many other states that do not have retrofit programs right now implemented. And that's it. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Ivy Al-Mufti. I'm a structural engineer with EERI in San Francisco, and I'm going to speak about business interruption and resilience. Before I begin, I'd like to thank the many contributors to this presentation. There was a lot of information that was shared. We were trading emails to very late last night, and so I hope I got everyone's observations into this presentation. So I'm going to focus on, I don't have much time. I've got a lot of slides, actually, so I'm going to go relatively quickly. But I want to focus primarily on small businesses in downtown Napa and wineries and wine facilities in the adjacent regions. I'm not going to focus on URM buildings, unreinforced masonry buildings, because Andre did a good job of covering that extensively. And I think we're all pretty well aware of what the consequences of the damage of those types of buildings have on business interruption. I also want to note that many of the businesses are still shut. It's still early days in the earthquake, after the earthquake. And so in some cases, we don't know the extent of downtime for many of these businesses. So I wanted to start off with an example of a small business called the Mustard Seed Clothing Company. It's a women's clothing store, because I think it it illustrates the many issues that business owners encounter in terms of business interruption in the aftermath of an earthquake. So the Mustard Seed was yellow tagged due to non-structural damage. They had broken storefront glazing and what I would call relatively minor plaster damage to the ceiling. There was no evidence of structural damage. The Mustard Seed was actually also adjacent to the Goodman Library, which Andre just mentioned in the previous presentation, which shed large stone bricks onto the sidewalk below. And actually, I don't know if you can make it out here, but in the corner here, one of those large bricks nestled itself up against the Mustard Seed. Now, it's not clear if the adjacency issues here influenced the decision to yellow tag this building. I will say that on the placard itself, there was no mention of the adjacency issues. It was just tagged due to the ceiling damage and the storefront glazing breaking. So we returned about a week later to the Mustard Seed, and repairs had still not begun. And that's probably because the business owner, Barbara, in this case, was not the building owner. And I think that's pretty typical for some of these small buildings. And so she was leasing it. It was not her responsibility, she didn't think, to make the repairs. She hadn't looked at her contract yet. So her status was in limbo. The business status was in limbo until the building owner decided to make the repairs. And so as a building owner, you might take stock of the building damage. You might get some bids. You might not want to replace the windows yet because there's aftershocks still going on. And so you can see how this contributes to some downtime for the business itself. Now, in Barbara's case, and in every single case in Napa, at least of the owners I spoke with, no one had either earthquake insurance or business interruption insurance. And so Barbara was very worried about her business, whether she could survive, even if it was shut for a few weeks after the earthquake. She was losing revenue every single day. So, and another thing was, even if Barbara did have the funds to repair this damage, and actually she didn't because she just spent a lot of her own money to make tenant improvements, so she didn't have those funds. But even if she did have questions. If I make these repairs, I get my building back to normal, what about this adjacent building? How do I find out if they'll lift my yellow tag? And again, this is an issue that I came across with many business owners in Napa. They didn't know who to contact to resolve their issues with the tagging. And so I think that, the Mustard Seed is really a good example of where relatively minor damage caused potentially significant downtime. Now, I hope this story has a happy ending. Barbara was actually offered space in a boutique across the street, a men's clothing boutique, where they give her a temporary space in the back to have her clothing. And I think this is a great example of where a tight-knit community like Napa is much more resilient to natural disasters. So I think that's really important to talk about when we talk about resilience of these communities. So now I'm going to take a step back and really talk about the primary causes of business interruption in general to businesses in downtown Napa. The earthquake caused relatively minor damage, minor structural damage, I will say, to non-URM buildings, to newer buildings. So the yellow tags, and in some cases red tags, were really given because of non-structural damage to these buildings, sometimes relatively minor non-structural damage, as I showed you in Barbara's case. Or if there is what I'm calling adjacency issues, when you've got a structure next door that poses some sort of risk to your building. I would say content damage in this case really wasn't a driver of business interruption for the most part, but there are exceptions to this rule, and I'll detail a couple of them. I will say my main takeaway in terms of contents is that we're still not doing a good job of anchoring these heavy contents. It's still a life safety issue. So business interruption is one thing, but life safety, I don't think we've solved that problem yet. So I want to talk about content damage first, because basically every owner I spoke to in Napa had some form of content damage, usually extensive. This was an olive oil store. You might have seen on the news, they lost about 600 bottles of olive oil. They cleaned that up on Sunday when I think their business was closed, as many other businesses were closed on Sunday regularly, and they were reopened on Monday. So many businesses were open on Monday after cleanup efforts on the Sunday before, the day of the earthquake. And so I will say that from our experience, content damage for these retail stores and for offices was not a big driver of business interruption. So probably of more concern, as I mentioned, is heavy contents falling. If the earthquake had happened at 3 p.m. instead of 3 a.m., I think we'd be talking about very different things here. I wouldn't be up here talking about business interruption. I'd probably be up here talking about injuries or fatalities. And so this is actually in a toy store. You can see this heavy shelf had fallen over, and I don't really want to think what would have happened if there was children in the store at the same time. And so the lesson here is very simple. Let's anchor our heavy building contents. This is a lab space at Napa College. You can see the racks have toppled over, probably damaging expensive equipment and contents, potentially lab specimens. And so, obviously some of these contents are no doubt priceless, especially if they're part of important research, right? And so the lesson here is let's protect our mission critical contents, especially if they serve the primary role in the building's function or the building's purpose. So now I want to talk about content damage at wineries and wine storage facilities. As we know, there was a lot of losses to the wine industry in terms of broken bottles, toppled over wine barrels that caused a lot of wine to be destroyed, unfortunately. But in general, I don't think this was a big contributor to business interruption. As we saw, many wine tasting rooms were open the day after the earthquake. I would say Napa, the tourism industry, hotels, wineries did a really great job of communicating to tourists, hey, keep coming to Napa, we're open for business. And I think that went a long way in the resilience or the recovery going forward. This is a wine barrel storage facility adjacent to downtown Napa. It actually stored wine for 45 different small high-end boutique wineries. And in this case, you can see in the picture here about 60% of the barrels toppled, 20% of those were blown or cracked. That's about 1,500 barrels. These were all full. And so the question here is, we've seen the news about the wine industry as a whole probably not being too impacted by this earthquake, at least for big wineries. My question is, can smaller wineries survive? They've sustained potentially heavy financial losses. Can they recover in the long term? And then again, this is a good example, I think, of a more pressing issue in some cases is a life safety hazard. These barrels are 600 pounds each. And so if this earthquake had occurred at 3 p.m. instead of 3 a.m. during harvest, then I think we'd be talking about very different things. The estimated time to restack all these was about 5 weeks. It's very hazardous, obviously. These can topple at any minute, and they're dealing with aftershocks as well. You can see in the bottom right that they've actually restacked these barrels in exactly the same manner as before the earthquake. And that's what I thought. That's not out of lack of care. It's because of urgency. They've got a harvest to deal with. There's really no other option at this point. So they are going to be revisiting, at least from what I understand, they're going to be revisiting their organizational operational procedures after the holidays. But for now, this is what they have to do to get through the harvest. The poor performance, I will say, of the two-barrel rack system is pretty well understood from observations in past earthquakes, and also some shake table testing at UC Berkeley that Josh Marrow did back in the year 2000. This is a very interesting case study. Two adjacent facilities about 1,000 feet apart from each other. One facility used a two-barrel rack system. About 50% of those barrels collapsed. And just down the road, the other facility used the four-barrel rack system, and only 2 out of 6,000 barrels toppled in that case. And so the lesson here is shouldn't we be using a four-barrel rack as a preferred alternative? We might need to do some more research on this type of racking, especially for more significant intensity earthquakes. There's still some extensive testing probably to be done. There's also a lot of damage to steel tanks, as Andre mentioned in the last presentation. In some cases, damage to the steel tank itself. You can see some buckling there. And in some cases, to the anchorage failing. And that's, typically with these storage tanks, they're not designed for seismic loads, surprisingly. And the anchorage is not properly detailed. So I think we can do better in terms of the design of these types of components. So I mentioned before that in terms of non-structural damage, there's relatively little structural damage. Non-structural damage did cause some buildings to be yellow tagged, in some cases red tagged. I'll show you that in a minute. On the left side here, some of the different non-structural components that caused buildings to be yellow tagged. You got broken pipes in many of the Napa County buildings, I believe, caused water damage, in some cases 2 inches of standing water. There's also electrical hazards due to that. That's what caused the building to be yellow tagged. There was damage to mechanical equipment. This one on the bottom right here was actually toppled over, and they uprighted it before we got there. You can see that if you've got mechanical equipment that's damaged, you can't really operate your building's functions. So you got to consider those. On the right here, some of the things that didn't cause business interruption in this earthquake, but I'm not saying that it won't in future earthquakes. You got displaced ceiling tiles. You've got relatively undamaged partition walls. So there was cracking in some partitions, but nothing major. I think this might speak to the fact that this earthquake, the characteristics of this earthquake really affected acceleration-sensitive components more than displacement-sensitive components like partitions. There was a lot of facade damage. One of the most surprising things that I found was that there was significant facade damage to relatively new buildings. This is the Andaz Hotel, downtown Napa. It shed some stone debris onto the street. It was yellow tagged and out of operation until Halloween. This is a three-story steel moment frame building. I'll call it the Charles Schwab building. I'm not sure of the name. The steel moment frame sustained no structural damage. There was a lot of content damage in this building, but you can see here on one side of the building, the facade, which was a stucco facade on metal studs, actually completely detached from the structure. You can see about a 6 to 8 inch gap from the outside. It looked like the structure was actually bowing. You couldn't tell that it was the facade only. This building was red tagged. We don't know what the downtime will be. And this causes adjacency issues. You can see in the background here, this is the same building. That's the side where the facade was coming off on. And in the foreground, these one-story strip shops were relatively undamaged. There was some content damage, and they were red tagged right after the earthquake. And so you can see where the adjacency issues come in here. A week later when I came back, some of them were green tagged. And I think this sums up the adjacency issues pretty well here. It says, our building is safe, the retrofit worked, we are closed only because of the building behind us. We'll see you soon. Thanks for your support, Velo. Pizzeria, I think. And so again, the call for potentially, as Andre mentioned, an orange tag, which is placed on a building that's undamaged but is tagged only because of adjacent buildings being damaged. A couple slides on hospitals and essential facilities. In general, hospitals performed pretty well. At the Valley Medical Center, there were three buildings that were yellow tagged due to mostly non-structural issues, they didn't hinder functionality as far as I'm aware. There's an air traffic control tower at the Napa Airport. After the earthquake, they had to transfer air traffic control over to Oakland Center because the windows were broken out, and there's apparently about several weeks to get new windows replaced, according to the FAA spokesman. Okay, so in conclusion, in general, I would say, there's a lot of causes of business interruption from this earthquake, but I think for the most part, they were either directly or indirectly caused by damage to non-structural components, at least for the non-URM buildings. So URMs, there's a different story. And I will mention, as Andre mentioned before, that tagging was unclear. I kind of mentioned it before in the mustard seed story. Tagging is a little bit unclear. Owners don't really know how to follow up. And so we do, I think, need to focus a little bit more effort on improving the tagging system.
So if I had to take all those observations and distill them into a few recommendations, this is what I came up with. I think the main lesson here, and it's not a new one, is that if we really want to prevent business interruption, we have to be designing our buildings to sustain less damage in an earthquake. It's really that plain and simple. So this earthquake highlighted particular vulnerabilities that I mentioned before, as you've seen listed here. But that's not to say that there are other vulnerabilities out there that we should address. So do we do that by implementing improved design standards is a question that I have. In terms of contents, I mentioned before, we've got to anchor our heavy contents. I don't know if that needs to be codified or if it's mandated by the local jurisdiction, but we can do better than we are doing right now. We've got to protect mission critical contents. Wineries, there's lots of things to do. There's a lot of things you can do to improve the protection of the wines. Utilize the four barrel racks, for example. Design your tanks for seismic loads. And then in terms of policy, you know, does this earthquake and other earthquakes before it, does it tell us that we should be designing our central business districts to be more resilient? Perhaps new buildings should be designed to beyond code standards, and perhaps older buildings should be upgraded, at least their facades. You can see all the facade issues caused adjacency issues, and I think there's ways of mitigating that. No one, again, that I spoke to had earthquake or business interruption insurance, and I think there's an outreach effort that we can do to educate people to get onto those kind of policies. And then tagging, as again I mentioned, can we do better to provide some additional information on the tag so owners can resolve their status of their tagging? And we mentioned the orange tag for buildings that are not damaged themselves, but other adjacent buildings cause them to be tagged. And I will say that Lawrence said they used this in Loma Prieta quite successfully. And so maybe we should be implementing that now. And then finally, you know, as an outsider, from my perspective, I think Napa has a very good outlook for recovery. A lot of the downtown was not damaged, and many of the businesses that were damaged are full of hope and optimistic, as you can see here from this post on the front of the Mustard Seed clothing company. Thank you.
Thanks very much. My name is Charles Scawthorne, and I'll be speaking on lifelines. I have a lot of material to cover, so I'll be going very fast. First of all, acknowledgments here. Most of these organizations are indicated. Most of the individuals are public employees and requested that the names not be used. But you can see there's a lot of people who contributed to this, and I'll come back to that at the end. The affected region is shown here with MMI superimposed on the population. You can see that about 200,000 people were subjected to MMI6. And about 36,000 subjected to MMI-8. These are the topics that are covered under lifelines. I will not be addressing all of these. The shaded ones, basically, I'll be talking about crude a little bit, about oil a little bit. But basically, the shaded ones I will not be speaking to. Highways I'll be speaking to very briefly. The next speaker will be talking about bridges. In general, the shaded ones did not sustain any damage, to the best of my knowledge. And contrary to most people's opinion, wineries are not considered a lifeline. lastly, I'll be speaking about fire following earthquake. So I'll start off with water. I focused on the city of Napa. There were breaks, as indicated in an earlier talk, in the city of Vallejo. But the city of Napa is served by three sources of water. You have Lake Hennessy up here, and the capacities and so on are indicated over here. You have the State Water Project comes into Barwick-Jameson pump station at this location. And then you have a third smaller seasonal source of supply here. These are the transmission lines that bring it into the city of Napa. These circles indicate tanks. There are a total of 12 tanks between the treatment plants and the various pressure zones. One of these tanks was damaged, indicated in red, and I'll be talking about that in a moment. This shows the breakdown of types of piping in the distribution system. There are 337 miles of distribution pipe in Napa, and you'll notice that about half of it is cast iron, which is relevant. There were breaks, of course. The total, there was 163 breaks shown here, Of those, 123 were cast iron. This shows the distribution of breaks at the various locations, or superimposed on the road network, not the piping network. And the percentages are shown here. So you can see that about 75% of their breaks were in cast iron pipe, whereas cast iron is 44% of the inventory. And lastly, this shows the breaks per mile of piping. So you can see that cast iron, in this case, has about 0.8 breaks per mile, or about one break per 1.2 miles. And that break rate, for example, is about 10 times what you would get for a steel pipe, five times what you would get for ductile iron pipe. They sustained one transmission line break, which was from that third, their seasonal water supply at Milliken. And it was a rock slide that took out about a 16-inch diameter pipeline. I have no other details simply than that. And the tank was the Montana B tank, a 1 million gallon tank here. You can see the dimensions and so on. It welded steel tank. It sustained sloshing. They estimate about 6 feet of sloshing, which damaged the roof. There's no evidence of elephant's foot buckling, but there was slippage, as you can see here, at an expansion joint for the outtake pipe at that location. So the tank moved a bit, but not enough to cause elephant foot buckling. That was basically the damage to the water system. So with regard to operation recovery, the city continued to flow water from the northern and southern sources throughout the immediate post-earthquake period in order to maintain pressure, both for firefighting as well as for drinking water. They estimated total loss using this policy of water was about 100 acre feet, which is really negligible. They were aided by regional utilities through the Cal Warn system. And you can see that, for example, East Bay Mud provided 5 trucks and crews. All these crews were released by the 29th of August, and they estimated they spent about $200,000 on spare parts. Total estimated damage, of course, including labor and so on, is much larger. This shows the recovery period of the repairs of the pipes. You can see that within 5 days, they had about half the breaks fixed, and within about 10 days, pushing about 80% of the breaks had been fixed. Napa Sanitation District, the water is what goes in, what comes out goes to the Sanitation District. You can see here, this is their service area, and basically, this is the treatment plant. It is about 2 kilometers from the epicenter at this location, and actually, most of that shaded area you'll see in a moment is ponds. It provides sanitary service for 75,000 people, has 270 miles of sewer pipe, ranging from 4 to 66 inches in diameter, 3 lift stations, 5,000 manholes. Tertiary treatment averages 6 million gallons a day in dry weather at the Susco Water Recycling Facility, which is shown here. This triangle piece is just actually this little piece right here. And basically, water comes in here, goes through various screening, filtration, primary treatment into a digester, which is right here, which is a large egg-shaped structure. They go to tertiary treatment, and then the water is released to the Napa River wet weather. In dry weather, it's used for irrigation on non-agricultural farms, and the so-called cake, the solids, is used as a fertilizer in non-agricultural fields. This shows the distribution of various kinds of pipe. Again, you can see that about 45% is asbestos cement pipe in the system. They had 11 breaks in all. All of the breaks were in asbestos cement pipe. Nine of the breaks were along the fault trace, and two of them, or what they believe was the fault trace, and two of them breaks were due to water main breaks. In other words, the water main eroded the soil, and eventually the sewer was broken too. There was minor cracking of reinforced concrete structures at the treatment facility. I looked at these, really not much more than hairline cracks. There was sloshing and some spillage of liquor from the sand filters. This was simply a cleanup problem. The recycling facility did not lose PG&E service. Their SCADA was uninterrupted. The lift stations lost PG&E service, but they had backup power, diesel generators at each of the lift stations, and they functioned quite well. And the biggest problem was what's called a plant upset. And that was actually the spillage of wine. When the wine was spilled, where did it go? Into the sewers. Came into the plant, and the wine basically, at the digester, you have anaerobic bacteria treatment, basically bugs, and the wine put the bugs to sleep. And the solution, so basically the plant shut down. So the solution was to inject oxygen or air rather, before the oxygen, into the digestion system. And they used their normal blower system and just ran it at max capacity. And within about 2 days, the bugs were awake again and doing their job. They estimated, an upper bound estimate of the total spillage that came in was about 6,800 barrels of wine. There was no unscheduled release of untreated water or solids due to this plant upset. Electric power, the area is served by PG&E. This shows the basically the high voltage grid. You have a 230 kV line crossing the Napa Valley here. There's a major substation at this location. These are lower voltages and so on. There's also some particularly unique structures. There's the Carquinez Straits crossing with relatively high towers. There was no, according to PG&E, there was no damage to the PG&E transmission system. There are 30 substations in the impacted area. By 2 o'clock the day of the earthquake, or about 11 hours after the earthquake, they had inspected all of these and found them, none were found to have been damaged. Teakley, Angela Schiff and John Eidinger, I think, were up the next day and also had inspected some of those, 6 of them, and they found very minor damage. The distribution system, which is 21 and 12 kV distribution voltages, had 63 spans of conductor damaged, 12 transformers, these are the pole top transformers, 15 cross arms and so on, no underground damage. 28 wires came down as a result of phase-to-phase slapping, where when they slap, they arc and it burns through a wire, and they came down. And there was a total of 76,000 customers had lost service at the peak, with 70,000 losing service for over 5 minutes. 99% of these were restored within 26 hours. And the California Public Utilities Commission has 2 measures of reliability, SAID and CAID. CAID is more relevant, and that is basically the customer something interruption duration index. It's basically the number of customers affected. That's what it is, customers affected interruption duration index. You take the number of customers affected, and their average time of outage was 315 minutes, or about 5 hours. And this is less than the 570 minutes, which is generally regarded by the CPUC as good performance. So did fairly well. This shows the restoration of time. It's taken from the Teakley report. The gas system is shown here. Basically, these are several high pressure gas transmission lines crossing basically along Highway 12 and then running up on Highway 29, or at least up along the Napa River. There were two non-hazardous leaks detected, no rupture of any line. These were regarded as a grade 3, and one of these was in American Canyon and made the news. These were repaired. Distribution system, no service loss due to damage to PG&E facilities. 160 customers lost service due to damage to their own facilities. PG&E responded to 5,800 service tags, which are the reports of gas leak or simply somebody simply requesting a safety check. And they had a total relights of 2,800, and these were completed by 25th of August, there's an error there, 25th of August, within about 24 hours. They had 26 priority zero leaks, zero is the highest priority, which is blowing gas. They had immediate response to those, and these are other statistics shown here. They had 76 regulators in the impacted area were inspected, none of them had damage. They have no information on the performance or even the presence of seismic shutoff valves. The PG&E just doesn't have that information. And while there was no leak or apparent damage, PG&E is replacing about 7,000 feet of one of the medium pressure lines in a newspaper article. It's going up Los Canaros Road, I believe. As a result of the performance on the electric and gas systems, PG&E received the key to the city of Napa. They were very... the people there were apparently very pleased by the performance. With regard to telecom, I don't have much information. As far as I know, the telecom system performed very well. The Verizon reported no loss of service. It had to bring in backup power for several cell towers. AT&T Napa Central Office appeared to sustain some damage. You can see a missing panel here. This panel is a wall on a penthouse here, and that apparently was bolted to the building providing for future expansion of the building. That apparently came down, you can see there was basically air conditioning, I believe it's air conditioning, being provided to the building through from external trailers. 911 functioned, so far as I know, although the fire department did have some difficulties I'll talk about later. With regard to rail, there are these various rail lines crossing the area here. Basically, bottom line, there was no damage so far as we know. I don't know about the rail bridges. But the number of services, the Capital Corridor line, Coast Starlight, and so on, California Zephyr, were all shut down for a number of hours during safety checks. So there was a little disruption of service out of conservatism. With regard to highways, all bridges and major roads were open. This is according to OES. There was minor damage. That'll be discussed. The bridge damage will be discussed next. Highway 12 sustained minor damage, but is open to traffic. Napa County Airport is quite close to the, here's the airport. It's about 2 kilometers from the fault. They reported no damage whatsoever, none to the buildings, runways, piping, or other equipment. The cracks that I think Tim Dawson showed, 1 millimeter, I guess they didn't consider those damage. Maybe they didn't see the cracks. The airport lost commercial power. It had backup power, which operated properly. I'll just make a point. The West Napa Fault crosses all three of their runways. And this was the fault trace as I understood it. Apparently there was some minor movement along somewhere around in here also. However, there is broken glass. And as you saw already, the tower, which is, does not belong to the airport, belongs to the FAA. So the airport said we had no damage. The FAA, however, however, had the broken glass. The tower has been inspected and was judged to be structurally sound, but is shut down while they're obtaining new glass. And they're operating from a temporary tower here, brought in on a trailer. It took them 4 days to bring this in. This is the kind of tower that's used for air shows. Apparently it fulfills the functions very well. The airport normally opens at 7 o'clock on the day they closed. They did their inspections in half an hour. They reopened the airport without air traffic control, which means that the pilots talk to each other, and that apparently suffices. Now, with regard to fire following earthquake, there were 6 fires in the area. You can see them up in this area here, with the most severe occurring almost immediately at the Napa Valley Mobile Home Park on Orchard Road. You can see it a little more clearly here. This shows the 6 fires with the time of report, and then all the pipe breaks overlaid on that in the water system. There was no report of the fire at Orchard at the Napa Valley Mobile Home Park. And it was observed by a fire engine responding to another incident. When they saw the fires, they went to the fire instead. When they arrived there was no water due to a broken water main that was serving the park. I provided some written detail to EERI and Pier. Basically, they called for water tenders from Napa County. Water tenders arrived within about half an hour. They evacuated all personnel nearby. And basically just made sure there was no loss of life until the water tenders arrived, and then they pretty quickly knocked it down. This shows the burnt area. There's actually 2 fires. This is the larger of the two. This is on Patty Way, and there was another one on Mark Road also. This is the burnt area on Patty Way. This is a panoramic shot of the fire ground at 317 Patty Way. In the scheme of things, no big deal. Some things that didn't happen, this is erroneous apparently. I'm sorry to say that recently one person did pass away, so there is one fatality. As far as I know, there were no dam failures, no train derailments, no transmission line, pipeline ruptures, no fires or explosions at oil refineries, and no major hazmat incidents. And I'll just point out that we have 5 refineries relatively close to this earthquake, and they represent a total refining capacity of 800,000 barrels a day, or 40% of California's total refining capacity, not affected by this earthquake. So in summary, population affected there. It was a moderate earthquake, although it did, of course, have pockets of high intensity. The most severe lifelines damage, I would say, was to the water main breaks. Prorating this to a larger event, you would have thousands of breaks. All lifelines seem to have done quite well, actually. And I call this a warm-up for a larger event, a Hayward magnitude 7, for example. With that, then, I'll go back to the acknowledgments again. Again, I want to thank all these people. And most of all, Hemingway said that courage is grace under pressure, and the people in Napa have certainly been very gracious. Thank you to them. Lastly, I'll just say that Teakley has a report. There's the URL for it. I think you can find it. If you can't copy that quickly, you can find it just by Googling. With that, thank you very much. And I'll let Mark introduce the next speaker.
Thank you very much. My name is Abul Hassan Aslani Asl. I am a professor at UC Berkeley, Department of Civil Engineering. And I will be presenting for a short time. I've been told to keep it in 5 minutes. So I will try to talk about steel bridges, concrete bridges, timber bridges, and stone arch bridges in the area. There are a large number of arch bridges, but I will focus a few minutes that I have on major steel, concrete, and some timber bridges as well. There will be a report that we are working on coming out of Department of Civil Engineering that will detail all the information that we gathered since earthquake. Our reconnaissance team spent 400 plus hours in the field and about the same amount in the office to provide you with the summary that I'm going to give you. The reconnaissance team consists of UC Berkeley participants, myself, and my two doctoral students, Cindy Sheen and Daniel Miller. We were very fortunate to have material scientists and forensic engineers with us. So our team includes also Berkeley Research Company engineers and scientists, Lisa Fulton, they are here today, and Dr. Bernard Cozzillo. We all participate in the field investigation as well as lab investigation and office of course. The most important bridge, perhaps, if we could make the lights a little bit less for these slides. These photos are mainly dark. Could you please reduce the light on the screen? Thank you. The most important bridge is this railroad bridge, Brazos Bridge. Very well designed, well done. It has two approaches that are timber trestles. This is a vertical lift bridge. It is incorrectly sometimes called drawbridge, but it is not. It's a vertical lift bridge. We investigated for a couple of days and many hours this bridge. We did not see any sign of movement. We did not see, of course, any sign of damage. We have investigated and documented up to this first bracing. We are in contact with Northern California Railroad, the owner, and we are hoping that we will be having access to the top part of superstructure to investigate and document the performance. This is another railroad bridge, which is a rotating bridge, bascule bridge, and this one is in a position that is open for ships and railroad track is stopped. We were not able to get on this bridge because the day that we were investigating this, we didn't have boat. But we also did investigation of bridges on Napa River using boat. So we were on the water level as well as above the bridge and, of course, underneath the bridge, investigating all the elements. These are the two important steel girder bridges in the area. This was reported as curved bridge. These are not curved bridge. These are skewed bridge. The girders are straight. The piers are displaced. As a result, it looks like curved. The bridge had some signs of movement, no structural damage. When I say structural damage about bridges, those of you who are not familiar with the notations in bridge engineering, bridges have two elements, primary members and secondary members. Primary members are those that carry gravity load. Those are primary and they should not be damaged. Secondary members are bracing and other elements for wind, and those are not what we call primary structure elements. So this bridge did not have any serious damage, but there were very many locations that we documented and measured movement of this bridge in transverse and longitudinal directions. The base plates at one point had slipped. This is a very interesting bridge. I love this because this is actually a trestle bridge. This is steel, but similar to trestle bridges of timber era, they have used steel piles. It's pretty corrosive water, but still everything was fine. Again, signs of about maybe 2-3 inches of movement everywhere, but not any damage. This is, of course, one that many of you know was heavily damaged. This is actually a pile-supported bridge. These are the piles driven down, extended up. Pile cap is sitting there, and these are reinforced concrete precast girders. This has many spans. This is not very major bridge. Traffic on it is very small. It just serves a power station there. The movement was certainly there in this direction, mainly in this direction towards the east. We are looking north. And you could see the top plastic information in almost all piles, with the exception of two end abutments and two immediately further from the abutment piles, which are usually short piles. So basically, the long piles moved in transverse direction and resulted in buckling as well as spalling of that. This is a concrete bridge, similar to that one, but this is, in fact, retrofitted. We went throughout this bridge. We did not see sign of movement. Of course, no damage. This is retrofit. This is another bridge, that's Caltrans bridge. This is the other one, concrete bridge. So I have to move on. These are a couple of concrete bridges that the city of Napa is building to divert the Napa River for a major development. So we documented some structural damage and some non-structural damage in these bridges, which are not understood. Some are, but some are not. These are like 5-6 bridges. This is the stone bridge, which had one of the stone bridges. Some of these stone bridges had the arch crack, as well as abutment and wing wall cracking. This is the wood bridges. This is a timber trestle. These are the brace frames in transverse and longitudinal direction. This is feeding into Brazos Bridge, and this is some other place as far as the expansion. So my last slide, the preliminary conclusion I have is this. Most bridge structures remain elastic with little or no damage. Few concrete bridges, this is important, has a structural damage, two of them serious. I showed one of them. The South Napa quake was not strong enough to represent a valid test of seismic design and performance of new and retrofitted bridges. With that, I stop and turn over to Mark. Thank you very much.
All right, so let's see if we got this guy back on. Great. So let's give all the speakers another hand. We really appreciate everybody sticking to their time. We really appreciate everybody sticking to their time and making sure that we got through it. So in terms of next steps, we know these presentations were all fairly condensed and we had to cram a lot in the 100 minutes that we had or so, as I mentioned before. So as a lot of the speakers already mentioned, there's going to be a lot more detailed information that's going to come out soon from the various organizations that are participating. There are some useful links here and some of the things to look forward to in terms of reports that are being getting ready to publish at this time. So with that, I think we're going to try and take some questions. Let's start maybe with a question from the audience here, and then we'll do some online questions as well. Oh, and maybe all the speakers could come up to the podium here so we make it easy to do the answer part as well. Well, maybe we can start with an online question then.
It's a three-way question. In ground motion, I noticed from the records from different places were out of sync by about 27 seconds, the CGS and USGS. I may have got the affiliation wrong there. On the Sonoma Hills record, has anyone looked at that? It almost looks like it's filtered one second. Pretty big pulse at 1 second. I don't know, maybe it's topographic. And the spike in the Carquinez, is there any possibility that there was impact, a very large impact, either from something dropping or abutment or expansion joint, high impact? Three.
I'm not familiar with your first part of your question, but in terms of Carquinez, I think travel path effects or something, because we see it in the Napa 37. But there's also a chance of a local basin effect. There's also side effects sometimes that lead to these things. And there may be SSI, but there may be soil structure interaction that needs to be explored further.
All right. I have a question for Andre. There was a very brief mention of fallen masonry chimneys. I was just wondering if you have a sense of roughly how many. It wasn't clear to me whether it was sort of rather minor or quite extensive.
I would say that especially in the city of Napa, there were quite a few. In terms of numbers, I don't have full numbers yet, but yeah, it would be interesting to see, especially as we move away from the main center of the city of Napa, to see how those damages evolve and when do they stop, in terms of when do chimneys stop falling and why. Yeah.
Yeah, and I can add on to that when we were driving up, we started to see chimney damage as far south as American Canyon. So some of the older residences there had chimney damage. The other thing I can add to that is that in Napa, there was the 2000 earthquake that some people alluded to, and that actually caused some chimney damage at that time. So the very weakest one maybe were already gone by the time this earthquake came around.
Let me just add to that. There was chimneys down in Vallejo also. On Mare Island, there's something called Admiral's Row, which is a bunch of old 19th century houses. All the chimneys came down.
Okay, so let's take a question from the online audience.
So a question from Robert Pike for Professor Bray is about levee damage. Do you have any observations about damage to levees?
We had team members specifically look for levee damage, and we saw no significant damage. There was one area on the southern part that may have had a little bit of liquefaction and minor cracking, but nothing of any significance.
Got more. So this next question is for both Andre Barbosa and Professor Bray. It looked like there was some inconsistency in the spectra that were shown on both of your slides, that whether the earthquake hit DVE or MCE, and do either of you have any suggestions on that, or is that something we should follow up on afterward and resubmit a spectra?
I know the spectra that I showed were not shown by Dr. Bray. So it may just be that it's different sites, and that's my comment.
Yeah. The GEER peer report is posted, so you can look at the details, and the appendix has many of the other strong motion stations, so you can look at those kind of details. But clearly the two that I showed, they had those values that exceeded the design spectra at those periods.
And then I'd also say that on the clearinghouse, there is actually a portion in the preliminary report section with a couple other spectra that various other colleagues have developed. So if someone's interested in that, there are several different versions that you could look at for more details.
Hi, I've got a question for Tim Dawson. This is about the surface rupture. You mentioned that after slip was significant in some areas. I was wondering, are there any general relationships between the proportion of after slip to the total slip at the surface?
I'm not really familiar with the afterslip that's been measured geodetically at depth. I'm just familiar with what we observed at the surface, which it was fairly significant within the first 28 to 48 hours, and it slowed down quite a bit. Jim Leenkamper at the USGS has been monitoring that, and I would direct you to him for any additional information.
Okay.
We have another question from Chris Lee, was asking about, were there any residential homes that were not allowed to shelter in place, and any thoughts on resiliency? So maybe Ibby, start that off, and anyone else, if you have thoughts on residential homes and sheltering in place and the need for shelters.
In the Browns Valley area, there were a number of houses that were actually red tagged and people were not able to shelter in place because of surface fault rupture.
I don't have anything to follow up on.
No. Yeah, just some of the clear mobile homes that were damaged, and people were not able to go back to those.
Any other questions from the audience? So I guess, Mark, you want to conclude? I can do one more question. One more question from Chris Lee came in about, were there any technology issues with the virtual clearinghouse? And compared to previous clearinghouse efforts, was there an increase in participation? So do you want me to just? So I would say that EERI and colleagues on the Clearinghouse Management Committee operated the virtual clearinghouse, and we've had actually great success with this clearinghouse. We've been able to launch a lot of our field collection tools. We have had a nice ArcGIS mapping interface that Marco was showing there. So I think we've had a great opportunity to allow more data to be shared than I think in the past. And it's nice that so much is geolocated so that people could go into this database and research further. We are looking on making further developments on having a better photo gallery that would allow people to search there. Also, we're looking at developing an interface that would allow us to actually just have a broader search, not by keywords, but just by metadata for key features in there. So we're hoping to work with our developers to roll that out before the next earthquake.
Yeah, and I would like to add, Heidi's work was phenomenal, but also Ann Rosinski, their leadership in terms of this was the most effective clearinghouse that I've participated in. The fact that you saw so many names on all of our slides show how collaborative it was. So it's tremendous success in terms of working together to understand and capture the data.
Well, all right. With that, I guess we'll conclude this today's presentations. Let's give all the speakers another hand, please.